I'll talk about simulations today. And I'll talk about agent simulations and how they can bring social change. Basically, initially, before getting into the core of my interest, I'll tell you a little bit also about my evolution as a personality. Right now, initially I was, as Victoria said, I was a social activist, so I'm a representative of Republic of Moldova. I was actively involved in the, all the activities in the Republic of Moldova. Here you see a picture from 2002, and maybe some of the people that are present here are even present on this picture. Also, except my involvement in protest, I also was involved in civic society and building organizations. One of the organizations that was created, included by me and by some other of my friends, one of the organizations that was created by me and some of the friends that are present here, it's called Media Point. And it's at a certain moment I understood that I want to not only protest against something that is happening out there, but I also want to build. I also want to build organizations. I also want to come with a certain change. So I am also a practitioner in a certain point of view. But I understood that it's not enough to want this change. It's very important to have ideas of how to bring that change. And I was thinking, where can I get those ideas? And I had some possibilities. One of these possibilities would be to speak with other people that have ideas, like people that are presented the thing today at TED, like people from the room, etc. But I was looking for an environment that is full of ideas, and this environment that is full of ideas is academia. What is academia if it's not an environment where you should create ideas, research if those ideas hold, and afterwards bring those ideas into the organizations, etc. So after having my experience as civic activist, I decided to go in academia. So I got to Tilburg University in Netherlands, right now initially, where I study in a research master in business organization and strategy. And I found out something very interesting, that my ideas are quite interesting for other people. So I found out that I was luckily accepted in a PhD program at Northwestern University. That is a PhD program, dual degree of Kellogg School of Management and Department of Sociology. Maybe some of you heard about Kellogg School of Management because they are quite in the same role with Harvard Business School, and they are competing for the same people. But this is the organization I was talking to you about. At a certain moment, I understood the following thing. I understood but during my studies and during being in academia, I understood that I got into something important for me. I was studying different philosophers, including philosopher of science, one of them being Karl Popper. And my desire is to create an organization, one of the greatest organization possible. But I'm looking for a theory how to do it. When I was reading Karl Popper, I understood the following. I understood that the theories have big problems in social sciences. They are difficult to test. Why? Usually when you are in physics, for instance, when you are creating a theory, you created a theory, and in order to prove that it is reliable for at least for a certain period of time, you should be able to test it. But usually you test it once, but it's not enough to test it only once. You should test it more than once. Usually if you are talking about physics, it's very simple more or less to reproduce the environment where you test a theory. But what about social sciences, and not about organizational sciences that I'm interested in, because I want to create a theory and afterwards to implement it and create a perfect organization. The problem with social sciences and organizational sciences that I'm interested in is that you cannot test the theories more than once properly. Why? Because the environment is changing. When you want to test a theory, there is a very important issue. You should be able to reproduce the conditions to encounter once again the same conditions later. If you, for instance, are testing the idea if apple is falling on the ground, so you test it now, you'll be able, like in 100 years, again to test it if the apple is falling down, because you can reproduce the conditions. In case of organizations, it's quite different. I was talking with one of my colleagues that is researching marketing, and he was talking to me about the research that was done in 1990s, so 20 years ago, about the brands of the shops, like why go to a shop that is called Albert Heijn in Netherlands, or maybe in Romania I was going to Carrefour, and I saw that Carrefour, for instance, on Albert Heijn had their own brands. And in the 1990s there was a research proving that those brands, usually the shops will have the brands, their own brands will be the cheapest brands. Right now, what's happening? I'm going to Albert Heijn, to the shop in my Tilburg, where I live right now. And what I found, I'm finding out that if I see an Albert Heijn brand, it could be the cheapest one, or it could be a premium brand. Right now, I'm thinking about marketing research. What should we do then with the marketing research that was done then? Practically, the conditions and the assumptions that were relevant then are not relevant now. So practically, what we thought then, it's not any more valid now. Practically, if we build a theory and we want to implement an organization in this period of time, it is quite difficult because the conditions are always changing. This is one of my first problem. One slide back, please. And the second problem that I have is that social science research is passive. Why I'm thinking like this? Please. Okay. Because social reality, because we can talk about two types of realities. We can talk about realities like physical reality that is more or less constant all the time, so that apple is always falling down, but we can talk about social reality and organizational reality. And that social and organizational reality is self-constructed. So we as people construct the reality. For instance, right now you are participants at TEDxChisinau. If this TEDxChisinau is a success or not, very much depends on the speakers, very much on the speakers, but it also very much depends on the participants. Why? Because if the participants would think, doesn't matter what kind of speakers do you have, if the participants will think that this event is a great event, then this event would be a great event. If we have here the best speakers in the world, you will get Bill Gates, you'll get Mark Zuckerberg, you'll get everybody who you know, Warren Buffett, I don't know, but you think that this is a bad event, then it will be a bad event. So the problem with social activities and the problem with organizations that we are living in a socially constructed reality. It's not only what the reality is, not that it is out there. Reality is because we created that reality. Those brands that I was talking about, they are not the lowest, the cheapest, or the high end just because they are like this, but because some entrepreneurs offer them a kind of meanings. But from my point of view, we have then a problem. First of all, the social sciences and organizational sciences, and in particular, cannot construct theories that can be tested. So if you read a certain organizational theory, you cannot know that it will hold for a long period of time. This is the first problem. And second problem, it's very difficult for me to understand But the organizational theory always and often talking about the past, about what others are doing. I'm in organization in international business, and I'm like looking at what is like a trend right now. One of the trends in the international business is the following. We are studying, or they are studying, if, for instance, you have a Japanese company, because a lot of research is on Japanese companies, and if you are like a Japanese company entering American market, the question is the following. Will you enter through greenfield or acquisition? Otherwise, in other words, will you build your own factory, or will you buy a factory and use that factory to build your own cars? This is a great, important topic that is right now researching international business. And I'd like to say that maybe many of you see a lot of very interesting, bright ideas, etc. But usually topics are quite specific in research, and they are this issue of foreign entry is researched from many, many points of view. But my problem with this is that the researchers are creating their theories of how what is okay, and afterwards there are consultants that, based on what's happening out there, are telling to new companies. So you see, according to our research, the best is to enter this way, through greenfield or acquisition, through building your own factory or through buying the other factory. My problem, as what's happening out there, is that the researchers are only seeing what others created, what the entrepreneurs created, but they do not come with their own solutions for the problems. So my concern is that we should have in organizational sciences something more closer to what's to engineering. What does it mean? It means that we should not only study what others said or others did, but we should also envision how can we do what kind of other possible entries we could have in that as a Japanese company in an American market. So this is our issue. So I was looking for solutions for myself. I was looking for solutions how we can create that great organization. And afterwards, I was looking for solutions to solve these problems that I'm concerned and that are more related to academia. And afterwards, is also related to the other people, to entrepreneurs, because academia is producing ideas. And my question is, could simulation help us? I found out the following, flying to Chisinau, to talk a little bit about simulations. Flying to Chisinau, I discovered something very interesting in a newspaper. In that newspaper, it was written that there was a research project that was simulating the brain, the human brain, and it won €1.5 billion European money just to understand how the brain is working. So I also got a confirmation that this simulation can help us understand one specific simulation type that is called agent-based modeling. And in this simulation, what's very important, and there is also a book, you can grow entire societies out there. Okay, just to show you some example of simulations, and I'll afterwards we'll link with what's happening. It's a simulation of a biological system, ecosystem. And in this system, we have two kinds of animals, two kinds of agents. There are sheep, first of all, first type of agents, and there are wolves, second types of agents. And they have some very simple behaviors. Wolves eat sheep, and sheep reproduce. It's very simple, but we could see some, on those graphics, there are some graphics that we see that at a certain moment, wolves are getting more and more, but ships less and less, you see? But at a certain moment, ships became so little that wolves could not find them. That is why wolves died out totally, and ships started to reproduce. This is a simulation that was that is agent-based modeling that is slightly coming from artificial intelligence. And we have here some kind of agents, these ships and these wolves, and these agents have some kind of very simple behaviors. But then, just programming those simple behaviors, we could see what is the general output at the level of the population, at the level of society. This is one of the simulation, and I'll show another simulation that is from social sciences. This is a Schelling model, and initially it has also quite interesting characteristic. There are two types of agents in this Schelling model, and these type of agents are blue and red. Nothing special. There are blue agents, people, and red people. And Schelling said the following thing. He said that these agents can move, first of all, and second, they have a preference. They have a preference of being around themselves with other, if you are red, with other red agents or with blue agents. So he set the following criteria. Let's see what will happen. Let's see what will happen if an agent has a preference of having only 30% of other agents around him of being the same color. Only 30. It's a lot, it's not. 30%. Let's see what's happening. You see? In a very short period of time, even if agent had a preference of having only 30% of the agents around them having the same colors with them, it is a complete segregation. We had practically all red agents with red agents and blue agents with blue agents. This is what simulation is helping us to understand. Right now, basically based on simulation, we could understand, first of all, test our theories. Why? Because when in simulation, you can always do and have the same conditions, only totally ideal. And secondly, we could, based on these simulations, do another thing. We could test our new theories and see how would a new organization, for instance, help us and help society, and how would that organization or new type of organization help us create a new type of society. Thank you.